So are you a friend or a family member cross-eyed? In eye care, we call that having strabismus, and it can cause a lot of problems with our eyesight and vision. So in this video, we're gonna break down what is strabismus so that you know what's going on and what you can do about it. Plus, stay tuned toward the end because I'll explain to you how I'm able to make my eyes look like they're cross-eyed, even though they're not. That's today's video. Let's take a look. Hey, welcome back. This is Dr. Alan here from the Dr. Eye Health Show, helping you learn all about the eyes, vision, finding the best vision products. If you like learning about the eyes, vision, taking care of your eyes, seeing your best, consider hitting the subscribe button down below and ringing the bell so that you don't miss any of our future videos. Now let's just imagine that you're a parent and you took your child into an eye exam and the doctor said something about your kid having an eye that's turning inward some of the time and that they may have strabismus or that they're developing lazy eye. Or maybe you read through the chart notes and you saw something like esotropia and you're like, I don't know what that means. And in the eye care world, when somebody has an eye turn, meaning both eyes are not looking straight ahead, instead one eye is either turning off to the side or turning inward or up or down, we call that having strabismus. And this happens to be one of the most frequently requested topics on this channel. So thank you to all of you guys who are subscribed and are active in the comments section. I really appreciate that. And having strabismus can lead to a lot of vision problems, especially later in life. And the sooner we catch it, the better. That's why I am such a huge advocate for pediatric eye exams and people having their children examined by an eye care professional early on in life, because a lot of just the vision screenings done at schools or like the vision check in the hallway at the pediatrician's office often misses strabismus and these different types of eye turns, especially if they're really small. So for all of you parents out there, I strongly encourage you, if you haven't had your kids' eyes checked and they do have maybe a subtle turn in their eyes or anything like that, definitely go get them checked out with an eye care professional. And that's even if your child doesn't complain that they have a vision issue, because they often don't even know it. They just have learned what their vision looks like and they don't know that they're not seeing well. Now, there are many different types of strabismus, and the nomenclature that we use in the eye clinic can be a little confusing if it's new to you. So let's just briefly go over the different types so that you can easily understand kind of what we're dealing with. First of all, our two eyes are meant to be looking straight ahead, and they're supposed to kind of turn in unison, kind of like the wheels of a car. They're supposed to turn left when you're looking left, they're supposed to turn right when you're looking right. But if somebody has an eye that just turns inward while the other is looking straight, we call that having an esotropia. Anything that's turning inward, we denote as eso. And if somebody is looking with one eye straight ahead and the other eye is kicking outward, we call that having an exotropia. And then it's also possible for an eye to be tilted upward, which we call hypertropia. And then we have somebody who has an eye that's going downward, and we call that having a hypotropia. It's also possible to have a mix of both an esotropia and a hypertropia, different angles like that. With these different deviations from straight ahead, in the clinic we like to measure and actually quantify how much of a deviation it is. So we'll measure that using prisms, and we'll denote it as something like 20 prism diopters of esotropia. Then of course we have to label it, is it the right eye, is it the left eye, or perhaps it's alternating, it's going from one side to the other. And that is possible, one eye may look turned in at one point, and then at another time, the right eye may be turned in while the left eye is looking straight ahead. It is also possible for this eye turn or this strabismus to be constant, meaning it is all the time, or it is intermittent, meaning it's only some of the time. Then your doctor can also measure this deviation and how severe it is in different directions of gaze. And if it's the same amount in every direction, we call that having a competent deviation. And if it's not the same in every direction, then we call it being incompetent or non-competent. Now these are just the basics of these different eye turns that we can have. There are also many other types of syndromes where the eye muscles don't quite work the way they're supposed to. Things like Duane syndrome or Brown syndrome, those are special cases. And that maybe we'll be able to have videos about those in the future. But for most of these basic cases, if somebody has like an esotropia where an eye is turned inward or an exotropia where the eye is turned outward, most of these cases are labeled as being congenital or infantile strabismus, something that occurs early on in life. For example, a child may be born or in early development has an eye that is stuck or is turning inward all the time. usually within the first 6 months of life, a baby will have some minor deviations in their eye muscle movements, but by about that 6 month mark, they should be pretty well straight ahead. So if you know somebody who has a child over the age of 6 months and they do have a suspected eye turn, definitely get them checked out as soon as possible. However, at that young of age, it is also possible to have something like a pseudo esotropia, where it looks like the eyes are not looking straight ahead, they look like they're crossed, but in fact, the eyes are looking straight ahead, and the child just has really large epicanthal folds, meaning they have a lot of excess skin nasally, kind of a flat nose bridge appearance, and it just kind of looks like their eyes are going crossed. But that's again why it's so important to bring your child in so that your doctor can really examine and determine if that is the case. Now, outside of being born with a strabismus, it's possible for somebody to acquire strabismus, especially for young kids. Again, around the age of 2 to 3, a child starts to develop their ability to really accommodate or focus on a near object. Think of it like 2, 3 years old, everything in your world is right in front of you, things that you can grab, toys, all those different things. And this is where strabismus can start to get really complex, and the whole idea of what's called accommodative esotropia is probably something that deserves a video all on its own because it does get rather complex. But I do think it's important to briefly mention because it does illustrate how important both our prescription or our refractive properties of our eyes influence the posture of our eyes and where our eyes sit and look in the different directions of the world, and how they can even influence the development of something like an eye turn or strabismus. Again, at a younger age, children are focusing a lot on their near surroundings. And if your child has a hyperopic or farsighted prescription, they already need to use their eye muscle inside their eye. That muscle is called the ciliary body. And they have to use that muscle to focus, to even see things in the distance clearly. So when they are focusing on a near object, they have to use their muscles even more. And the interesting part about eye care and just the eyes in general is that that muscle, this focusing muscle to keep an image clear up close, is neurologically tethered to the same muscles that turn your eyes in and outward. And we call that convergence and divergence. So when your eyes are converging and they're focusing, it basically is pulling it all together. And so for one of those children, for example, when they're looking at a near object, their eyes are going to compensate for this high amount of near focus by also pulling the eyes in together, forcing them to basically go cross-eyed. And this becomes a major problem, as with a lot of people who do have a strabismus or one of these eye turns, is that eventually the brain starts to have trouble holding that position, and one eye tends to want to give up and just kind of kick out or not be in alignment. And as you could imagine, that often results in something like double vision, or diplopia as we call it in the eye clinic. And our brains do not like double vision. It's very difficult to see. You can't really function and understand what's going on. So our brains, as magical as they are, have learned to adapt to this subtle double vision by doing something called suppression. And that's where our brain just, even though it's able to see these two images, just decides, hey, that's confusing. I'm just gonna mute off that eye that's not working right. Usually ends up being the eye that's working too hard and doesn't have as clear of an image. And hence, it usually ends up giving good eyesight out of one eye and not the other. And although how the brain suppresses this other eye is advantageous in that we're not seeing double, it does cause some other neurological consequences with visual development. Namely, a condition called amblyopia, or having a true lazy eye. And we did a video on amblyopia and lazy eye last year. And if you want to know more about that, again, that's another really in-depth topic of discussion. In fact, I had to take full dedicated courses on things like strabismus and amblyopia and the treatment, the management of it when I went to school for eye care. So I do have a dedicated video on that, and I do encourage you to check that video out. I'll put that up in the YouTube card above here, as well as in the YouTube description below, so you can open that up and watch it at your leisure just to learn a little bit more. Now, outside of having strabismus as an infantile reason at a young age or accommodative reason, you can also have them for acquired reasons later on in life. And this could be due to head trauma, being struck in the head really hard. It could be from other medical causes, such as severe diabetes, or something tragic like having a brain tumor or an aneurysm, anything that affects your neurological connection to your eye muscles. These different forms of acquired strabismus are often often called paralytic strabismus, as the muscles are paralyzed for some reason. For example, if you have head trauma, it usually ends up damaging the fourth cranial nerve, which controls one of the superior oblique muscles to the eye. It's usually the most commonly damaged in trauma, leading to problems with vertical diplopia. Or if you have increased intracranial pressure, this can push on the sixth cranial nerve, which controls the outward movement of the eye, and if you can't do that, then your eyes are naturally going to kick inward. Or again, if you're somebody who has a long history of uncontrolled diabetes or high blood pressure, this can also cause problems with the eye muscles. Thankfully, in those cases, it's usually transient and does get better on its own within several months. A big differentiating factor between young kids with strabismus and adults with acquired strabismus has to do with the symptoms. And that's mainly because adults, being that they've already learned to see the world with both eyes working together, when you suddenly have this deviation in one eye compared to the other, then you typically will have double vision or diplopia. Where young kids who've developed strabismus at a young age have again learned to suppress an eye and often end up with something like a lazy eye. And so they don't end up seeing double vision. And all of this does play a role in how we treat and manage these different conditions. So when it comes to the different types of strabismus treatment and things that you can do, first of all, young kids need to get strabismus diagnosed and with an eye care professional so they can start managing what's going on and really how we can start treating it. The first and easiest treatment for most people, especially for infantile causes of strabismus, is first glasses. Again, the power or prescription of glasses, the refractive error, usually a lot of these kids are farsighted. And in that case, wearing glasses may correct the problem at large. But again, usually it's better if caught earlier. Because our main goal with strabismus at a young age is not just to correct the eye and get it looking straight ahead, but to prevent neurological maldevelopment of the visual processing centers. And that has to do with, again, that term amblyopia or lazy eye, preventing lazy eye from settling in. And outside of just glasses, especially for young kids who are at risk of amblyopia or lazy eye, your doctor will also usually prescribe some type of occlusive therapy. This involves using an eye patch or some type of atropine eye drop to the better seeing eye, to try to penalize the better seeing eye and force a young child to start utilizing the eye that's not coordinated, not looking straight ahead, isn't developing as well. Sometimes glasses can be outfitted with prisms built into the glasses to help shift the retinal image into alignment with both eyes. That is a possible way to help people, especially adults who have permanent strabismus where they're just constantly seeing double. That way you get rid of the double vision. Usually prisms are ground into the glasses permanently, but there are also temporary prisms called Fresnel prisms, which are kind of a press on to the glasses sort of thing. There are some other eye muscle movements such as vision therapy or also known as orthoptics, which may have a small role in strabismus. Usually, in my experience, it's more for acquired strabismus after something like a traumatic brain injury may have a little bit better effect, but it is something that may be included in recommendations. But for many people, both infantile as well as adult strabismus, especially if it is a large deviated angle, whether it be ESO, EXO, or anything, oftentimes surgery is needed for strabismus. Strabismus surgery can be really important, especially again in the younger ages, because if we can get both eyes to be relatively in alignment, then we can again get the brain to develop good vision even in the first place. Because the brain can learn really well. We call that having neuroplasticity, and it's usually much better in younger ages, around the age of 8, 9, all the way up to maybe 12. Then it starts to continually kind of go downhill, and we have a harder time with that neuroplasticity. But for people who are older, in cases of, let's say, adult strabismus, it is also possible to have these eye muscle surgeries too. Oftentimes people will do this for cosmetic reasons because it can be pretty devastating. I've had people comment down below about their experience growing up and being teased or bullied as a kid or as an adult because their eyes are going in different directions and it looks unsightly and people just don't know how to react to it when one eye is off looking a different direction. Which is really tragic, and you can see why somebody wanting to get strabismus surgery can be a big thing for them. But unfortunately, as an adult, if somebody already has amblyopia rooted in and they decide to get strabismus surgery later in life to have both eyes looking straight, It may make the eyes cosmetically look orthoptic or looking straight ahead, but it doesn't necessarily waken up that eye and make it see better. Because it's not necessarily the eye or the receptor that has the functioning problem, it's really the processing centers for that eye within the brain. Now, I know again that strabismus and amblyopia, all of this can be a really complicated topic, but I encourage you to drop your comments in the comment section below. Any questions you have, let us know your story. Have you had strabismus or amblyopia since you were young? Do you have a family member who is going through this and you want to connect with other people who may have gone through it too? Definitely connect with other people in the comment section. I want this channel and these comments to really connect people, to encourage other people, and just kind of learn from everyone's experiences. For a little change of topic, I've had people ask how I'm able to make it look like I have an eye turn or that I have some sort of an esotropia, even though I really don't. And I just wanted to kind of share this as kind of a fun thing. I don't encourage people to try this on their own and try to hold it for long periods of time, but it's just a matter of, again, trying to look at the tip of your nose, trying to go cross-eyed, and in the distance, if you hold that, everything should go double. Like right now, I'm seeing two of everything. I'm seeing two different cameras. And that is normal. That's called physiological diplopia. Such if you look at one single object, like keeping your finger single here, in the back distance, I see double of everything. But if you're able to go cross-eyed, see double of everything, focus on one image. Again, there's two cameras. If I focus on the camera over on this side, it makes one eye look straight ahead while the other eye turns inward. And I can do that to the other side too. I can switch to the other eye. And then I just let it go and relax, and I'm back to having my regular focus. Now, of course, if you have strabismus yourself, this isn't gonna work, but if you just have normal vision and you're watching this just to learn, then maybe you can give it a try. It's kind of fun. Now, with today's video all being about strabismus, I do strongly encourage you to check out my video on amblyopia, because they are very much tied together. They can occur independently for different reasons, but again, they do have a lot of relationship together. So to check out that video, click or tap the screen up here to the side. Again, thanks for watching. Keep an eye on it, and we'll talk to you soon.